Before we begin, I just want to say something. If you see some songs here, that it will say, well, this song came from the Seventh-day Adventists, or from the Baptists, or from so forth and so forth. I'm grabbing my songs from the public domain and songs that are not, at this point, copyrighted. And some of these songs, the people who sings them, I might not agree with their doctrine. But the song is doctrinally sound, because they're singing a song that was written by a hymn writer, that his doctrines are sound. So just letting you know before anything else. Okay, I want to go to Exodus verses chapter 17, verses 8 to 16. Here we see the victory over the Amalekites. Now Amalek came and fought with Israel in Rephidim, and Moses said to Joshua, "Choose us some men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand." So Joshua did as Moses said to him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses and Aaron and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And so it was, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands became heavy. So they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Write this for a memorial in the book and recount it in the hearing of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven." And Moses built an altar and called its name, "The Lord is my banner." The name is Yahweh-Nissi, or Jehovah-Nissi. For he said, "Because the Lord has sworn, the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation." The literal sense says, "A hand is upon the throne of the Lord." Okay, now, the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. But what's the name that the Lord is given here? The name the Lord is given is Jehovah, or the Lord is our banner. What is a banner? A banner is a sign of victory. A banner is like a flag. It's a flag. It's something that represents you. Something represents your nation. God gives us victory against the flesh, the world, and the devil. Our battles are his battles, of light against darkness and good against evil. God is our victory. God is our victory. We read in Isaiah 11, verse 10. What does it say? Isaiah 11, verse 10 says this: "And in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, who shall stand as a banner to the people. For the Gentiles shall seek him, and his resting place shall be glorious." Talking about Jesus. Jesus is our banner, is our flag. It's what is who represents us in the eyes of the Father. It's who represents us in the eyes of the world. Jesus is our banner. Well, the Israelites had Jehovah as their banner. Well, we have Jehovah as our banner, which is Jesus. Jesus is Jehovah. Jehovah the Son. We're going to continue with this. And we want to go to a hymn. And we're going to go to this one that says, when we all get to heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Mother says she pushes the button.
Okay, praise the Lord.
That's the music rhyme.
And
I love every one of those songs.
Praise the Lord. I don't think that song is complete. When I downloaded it, I think it comes with somebody else talking or something. I saw that. I quickly took it out.
Same old beautiful.
We want to go to heaven. We want to see Jesus.
For life.
And
it was untrained, but it was just gorgeous.
There's only one way to get to heaven, and that is through Jesus Christ. So it's just amazing when that day comes. Sooner or later, we will experience that day in our lives. Now, when we die, the Bible says, Hebrews 9:27, necessary a man to die once, after that, the judgment. We read in Deuteronomy, we read the following. Deuteronomy chapter 20, verses 3 and 4 says, "And he shall say to them, Hear, O Israel, today you are on the verge of battle with your enemies. Do not let your heart faint, do not be afraid, and do not tremble, nor be terrified because of them. For the Lord your God is he who goes with you to fight for you against your enemies to save you." The Lord goes before us to fight against our enemies, just like He went with Israel to fight against the Amalekites. Amalekites. He went before Israel and he fought. It is true that that Moses' hands needed to be lifted up in a form of praise to God, because as Moses lifted up his hands, Israel received victory. And when Moses put down his hands, Israel was being defeated. And it's a sign for us as we go in this battle, we have to have our minds on the things above, on things up, on God. If we have our eyes on God, we will be victorious in our Christian walk. But if we have the eyes on the things of this world, the things that are perishing, we will be defeated. It's just like Peter, where Jesus called him to walk on water. Well, Peter had his eyes on Jesus. Peter had the ability to walk on water, to do the impossible. But when his eyes was taken away from Jesus, what happened? Peter started to sink. And this is what God allows. Moses, having his hands lifted up was a sign of praise, was a sign of adoration. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 12:14. Actually, not 12:14. I really forgot. And it was 12 verse 12. Hebrews 12 verse 12 says, "Therefore, strengthen the hands which hang down and the feeble knees." In our form of praise, it's good to lift up your hands in praise. Look at what 1 Timothy 2 verse 8 says. "I desire therefore that the men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting." Lifting up your hands is a sign of victory. And we see Jesus with his hands stretched up when he died for our sins. Lifting up your hands is a sign of victory. It means that still life in you. You have not been defeated, though you are bruised, because you have God as your banner. You have Jesus as your flag. You could go to war with confidence, knowing that you have this battle already won. Let's go to this song. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, He passed and we follow Him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. And turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, He promised. Believe Him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, His perfect salvation to tell. And turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. And and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Ephesians chapter 6 verse 10 until verse 18 tells us, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." The schemes of the devil. "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore, having girdle your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints." When it tells us to put the whole armor of God, it's telling us to put on Jesus, for He is the armor of God. Every part of this armor that you are to wear represents Jesus in one way or the other. We're told, having girdled your waist with truth, Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." You will find truth in Christ. Having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. What is the gospel? The gospel is about Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and us having peace with God through that. Having the breastplate of righteousness. What is the breastplate of righteousness? Jesus is our righteousness, the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 30. So you see, every single thing that is telling you to do, to have, is to have Jesus. To have Jesus in your thoughts, in your mind, to be continually in communion with Him. It's the only way we will have victory. Praying without ceasing, without resting. Our mind needs to be always on the things of God. We can't take our mind away from God. Because it's just like Peter. Once we start taking our minds away from God and focusing on our problems, we stop looking at our banner, which is Jehovah-Nissi, which is our Jesus. And when we stop looking at Jehovah-Nissi, our Jesus, you know what happens? We stop lifting our hands. And what happens? Amalek starts having the victory. The flesh starts being victorious over our lives. The thoughts patterns, we start thinking about other things. When you're not thinking about Jesus, other things goes in really fast. It's easier to make a nest for birds of all kinds to enter in. When you don't have that protection anymore, that fence, that barbed wire, which is Jesus, to keep them away. Lift up your banner. Lift up your hands. And start seeking Jesus more and more. Start dedicating your life to Him more and more. Because when we take our eyes off of Jesus, we're opening doors for disbelief. We're opening doors for so many things. And it's hard to have a pure heart when you're not looking at Jesus. What does Amalek represent? It represents our flesh. We see God saying in Deuteronomy 25 verse 17, remember what Amalek did to you on the way as you were coming out of Egypt. Remember what the flesh has been against you. The flesh has gone against you in every single way in your walk with God. God tells King Saul the following in 1 Samuel 15. Verse 1 and 2. Samuel also said to Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, heed the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel. Now he ambushed him. How he ambushed him on the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that he have, and do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, infant and nursing child, ox and sheep and camel and donkey. Oh, that was a command. That was a command to King Saul. You better kill Amalek. What did King Saul did? King Saul left Amalek's king alive and his goods. He did not destroy Amalek. It made Samuel very mad. Samuel became very mad at King Saul. And he said this. Samuel said this to King Saul. Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. Because Saul brought a sacrifice with the ox and all this stuff, and it was supposed to be destroyed. Everything was supposed to be destroyed. For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity of idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king. Now, if we go to 2 Samuel, there's something interesting to know. It is something very interesting to know. In 2 Samuel 1 verse 1 it says, now it came to pass after the death of Saul, when David had returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites. Sometimes I pronounce it right, sometimes I don't. Amalekites. And David had stayed 2 days in Ziklag. Someone came to David. And it was an Amalekite in verse 8. And guess what happened? I want you to notice something. Because Saul failed to kill Amalek and to kill its king. Guess who did the killing of King Saul? Who killed King Saul? Who cut King Saul's head? It was an Amalekite. We read in verses 9 of 2 Samuel 1, and he said to me, again, please stand over me and kill me, for anguish has come upon me. That's King Saul talking to the Amalekite. But my life still remains in me, so I stood over him and killed him, because I was sure that he would not live after he had fallen. And I took the crown that was on his head and bracelet that was on his arm and have brought them here to my Lord. Oh, this is a lot like the flesh. When it tries to make us prideful. But it didn't work for David at that moment. Verses 11, therefore David took hold of his clothes and tore them. So did all the men who were with him. And they mourned and wept and fasted until evening for Saul and for Jonathan his son, for the people of the Lord and for the house of Israel, because they had fallen by the sword. And then David said to the young man who told him, where are you from? And he answered, I am a son of an alien, Amalekite. So David said to him, how was it you were not afraid to put forth your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? Then David called one of the young men and said, go near and execute him. And he struck him, so he died. Notice David killed Amalek. But Saul, because he let them live, he did not kill them all. He ended up killed by one of them. Now, this is like our flesh. When we don't kill our flesh will kill us. When we don't subdue this flesh to the word of God, the flesh will subdue itself on us. We either will serve the flesh or serve Jesus. Sin will keep us from serving him. And serving Jesus will keep us from sin. The Bible and prayer will keep you from living a life in the flesh. But living a life in the flesh will keep you from the Bible and prayer. The more holier you are, the less you want to sin. And when you sin, you feel worse than anything else. Anyway, we need to keep our eyes on our banner, which is Jesus. Let's hear a hymn called My Jesus, I Love Thee. My Jesus, I Love Thee.
Yeah.
Lord bless everyone, and I'll see you next program of Mr. Kakoulides and the Bible podcast. I love you all, and tonight we will be recording. And I just wanted to let you know, we need to get in the book of Matthew and Genesis, and I've just been kind of bogged out on some other things, and that's why I've just been preaching certain topics, but I do want us to go through the Bible, and I do want to answer your questions. If you have any questions on the Bible, please send them to revkakoulides@gmail.com, and your question will be answered on the program. Sunday, I had talked about the topic on the book of Daniel, and I believe a dear sweet brother brought me a email. I can't pronounce his name, I'm really sorry. And it was at least, I guess, like 100 pages. He emailed me a book, pretty much. In length, the email was like 100 pages. I told him I was going to read it, and I was going to let him know what I thought about it. I still haven't read it, but I will be reading it and making a comment on it, probably on the program or something. Okay, Lord bless you guys, and have a blessed day. Love you all, and take care. Bye.